It's mid-April. As violence breaks out in Sudan, disturbing images of possible war crimes are emerging, being carried out on medical facilities and staff by both sides. The warring factions of formerly allied militia empty the streets of the capital. We wanted our contacts on the ground to verify what's going on, but it's impossible. Using satellite data and mapping tools, we analyzed user-generated content on a huge scale and spoke to dozens of doctors to build a picture of whether war crimes are being committed and the impact this is having on millions of people. So how did this conflict begin? On the one side, there's the government Sudanese army, often referred to as the SAF, led by this man, General Fateh al-Burhan. Opposing him is General Mohamed Degalo, Hemiti, who runs the Rapid Support Force, or RSF. The two forces were due to merge. But when talks between them broke down, a bloody fight began, leaving civilians caught in the shrapnel. Reporter Fateh Rahman Al-Hamdani lives by the international airport, right at the heart of the fighting. But it's hard to reach him, so he sends us videos when he can.
لليوم الرابع على التوالي نحن تحت القصف وللأسف ما عندنا كهرباء أصوات اشتباكات نحاول أن نهرب من القصف بأي شكل من الأشكال يحاول أن أضعها تحت السرير بالنسبة للمياه كالعادة إلى الآن لا يوجد حتى قطرة ماء واحدة.
And here is why. This is one of Khartoum's main water treatment plants. On the first day of fighting, it was hit. Using satellite imagery, we can see the damage. In this image in 2022, the tanks are full, but here, only days after being bombed, they're almost empty. Just across the river from the water plant, living opposite the British Embassy, is British citizen and London hotel owner, 85-year-old Abdullah Sholgami, and his wife, Alawiya Rishwan. Their granddaughter, Azhar, has been trying to reach them from her home in New York.
That area, you can't leave. A child got shot in front of my grandparents' house. There's snipers everywhere in that area.
On April 25th, British nationals began to be evacuated from Sudan. They were asked to make their way to an airport 25 miles from Khartoum, crossing a war zone. Azhar's uncle and cousin called the Foreign Office helpline for assistance.
My mother is 80. To get her to the wheelchair, it needs sometimes three, four people.
We do need to stress that there is no way for them to leave their location.
The person they spoke to sympathized with the family, but the embassy couldn't help them. Trapped in their home for days, with no food and water, Azhar's grandfather leaves his home to try and get help.
5 minutes into his journey, he got shot. 3 bullets, his hand, chest, lower back. Then we lost touch because no electricity and then we didn't have a way to call them. And by that time, my grandmother was already alone for 5 days or so, alone, disabled, no food, no water. The last time we spoke to my grandmother, she was telling us that the RSF is raiding the house.
Wounded on the streets of Khartoum, as her's grandfather desperately searched for a hospital. But this wasn't easy. Hospitals were now shutting down. At the start of the conflict, there were 88 hospitals operating around Khartoum. By the 20th of May, 61 had closed. Some had been bombed. One of the first is Ibn Sina Hospital. Dr. Ala is a surgeon there.
هل أعطوكم إنذار إنه المستشفى تستهدف؟
فأي إنذار؟ فجأة تحصل يعني تحصل بوم في المستشفى يحصل يعني قنبلة. المستشفى اللي بدي أعمل فيها في ابن سينا فيها ثلاث قنابل خصفت والقنبلة الرابعة في سكن الممرضات احترق بالكامل يعني.
We investigated. This picture of the hospital matches this image showing the damage from the attack. A forensic weapons expert told us it was most likely caused by artillery fire. There are also videos of a fire at the nurses' accommodation, seen here behind this distinctive building. We can see the nurses' accommodation on the satellite image. In this later one, they've been damaged. We can't be certain who was responsible or if this was a deliberate attack.
The fact that there was no warning given prior to a strike may well constitute a war crime.
We took our evidence to Dr. Christian DeVos and Dr. Hussam Al-Nahas, international criminal law experts from Physicians for Human Rights.
Leila في مستشفى الرومي في درمان في مغزوف وقع في داخل المستشفى وكل الناس جوا على أساس إنه يتعالجوا. المغزوف وقع فيهم وسبب لهم أضرار بالغة جدا.
There was patients receiving care, there was healthcare providers providing healthcare. The destruction within the facility is clear.
15 people were reported injured in this attack.
Even if it wasn't an intentional attack on the hospital, the fact that a bomb or mortar shell can then damage the hospital so severely and the patients inside does raise questions again about adherence to the laws of war.
طيب مخزون المياه عندي هنا فقط عبارة عن 33 ملي.
أنا خارج المنزل حوالي الساعة 3 الظهر.
هذا السوق عبارة عن مدينة تسكنها الأشباح.
كل الأسواق كلها حتى تقاطع الشرقي ما فيه أي موية. أطلقوا عليها النار هسي يعني بصورة كثيفة. الوضع مأساوي وصعب للغاية. وضع حرج. بس أنا قاعد أنزل أمشي في بيتنا بأي طريقة.
بعد ما نجوت بعجوبة من رصاص الدعم السريع. وصلت الآن وصراحة محتار يعني في المشهد اللي حصل يعني بإن كانوا إنهم عادي ممكن يقتلوا شخص عشان شافوه إنه يصور أيا كان اللي بيصوره شنو يعني فدي حاجة مؤسفة للغاية وسيئة يعني.
From thousands of miles away, Azhar was aware her grandmother was living the same reality. She was desperate to save her. We've seen emails between Azhar's family and the British ambassador in Sudan. They point out her grandfather is British, and they've been trapped for weeks without food or water. The ambassador responds, with the embassy now closed, there's little they can do. He promises the embassy will be in touch, but no one contacts them. Azhar hadn't heard from her grandparents for 5 days. Then she received a call.
It was one of the diplomats in the Turkish embassy. And then he goes off to say that, I'm sorry to tell you this, but you went inside and your grandmother passed away.
I'm so sorry, that's so heartbreaking.
And they were physically just across the road from the British embassy, right?
Maximum 4 steps away, maximum. And it just breaks my heart to think that she died alone. And she died because she was alone. And she's still alone to this very moment. And she might be buried alone, none of her family members around her.
And I'm sure your family did everything they could to try and get them out.
Everything. What happened to my grandparents was a crime against humanity, not only by the RSF, not only by the SAF, but by the British Embassy. Because they were the only ones that could have prevented this from happening to my grandparents.
تبادل بين أكثر من طرف في أثناء الاشتباكات ضرورة هناك طفلة تعيش في المنزل المقابل لمنزلي وهي نائمة حوالي الساعة الخامسة صباحا سقطت عليها رصاص مضاد طيران
Two weeks into the war, East Nile Hospital was one of the last operating in the area. Reports started emerging of patients being forced out from the building. The RSF had surrounded it with their vehicles and anti-aircraft weapons. On May 1st, a public area next to the hospital was hit by an airstrike. The army are the only ones with such capability. Our sources tell us there was no warning and that doctors were treating civilians and RSF soldiers at the time.
The duty to warn of any impending airstrike and to ensure take due precaution that all civilians are able to evacuate the hospital prior to an airstrike. That is very clear under the laws of war.
Five people were reportedly killed. 2 weeks later, the hospital was hit by another airstrike.
هذا ما تبقى لي من ماء عشان ابلع حبة تخيلوا بس عشان ابلع حبة
Throughout the conflict, there have been allegations of RSF soldiers taking over hospitals. This video shows them entering Al Saha Hospital.
دي اللي صاب يمكن الحالة العشرين وجايين على المستشفى بس حاليا يعني الطوارئ بتاعتنا كلها عبارة عن دعم سريع.
And here inside the hospital, we see soldiers outnumbering civilians. The World Health Organization has reported 9 confirmed cases of hospitals being taken over by the warring parties.
I think it's important to note that by providing medical care to soldiers in the context of conflict, that is not itself a violation of the law of war. I think the question that some of the video raises is both the preferential treatment potentially between civilians and soldiers. That is not an appropriate use of a medical facility and it may well constitute a violation of the laws of war.
But it doesn't end there. Doctors are also being targeted. We've seen messages widely circulated on social media, threatening doctors by name, even sharing their ID number. They accused them of supporting the RSF and receiving money from abroad.
لجنة الأطباء المركزية من اللي هي يسمى من الليلة لجنة المتمردين ما من ما أطباء لجنة المتمردين والمجلس المركزي وعلى الدين نقول أنتم مسلمين ولا كفار.
Two doctors told us they've had to go into hiding. One of them spoke to us but wanted to remain anonymous.
Doctors treat whoever comes to them in these hospitals, but in spite of this, they've received many threats, death threats from the remnants of the previous regime. They accuse them of supporting the RSF. Because of these threats, doctors have had to stay away from these hospitals and have had to go into hiding.
كراهين لعلاج مرضى مصابين أو مصابين الدعم السريع. هو معلوم لدينا تماما أن دي هي وسيلة يتم استخدامها في الحروب للضغط يعني وهي محرمة بكل يعني القوانين العالمية.
Sudanese doctors' organizations have been monitoring threats which they say are coming from both sides. Another potential war crime.
مرحبا معي أستاذ مصطفى.
For weeks, we've been trying to put our allegations to both parties. I asked Mustafa Mohammed Ibrahim from the Rapid Support Forces about the targeting of hospitals and evidence of possible war crimes.
ده ليس احتلال، إنما نحن قواتنا هي منتشرة وموجودة وبتأدي دورها الأمني فقط ولم تمنع حتى مواطن من العيش في هذه المستشفيات. لماذا لم يخرج المدير الطبي لأي مستشفى يتحدث يقول أنا تم احتلال مستشفانا بواسطة قوات الدعم السريع؟ لماذا لم يقم ذلك؟
لأنهم بيخافوا.
لأنهم بيخافوا من من؟ لأنه الكلام ما غير حقيقي، الكلام غير واقعي.
لكن المعاملة التفضيلية للجنود على المدنيين ليست استخداما مناسبا لمنشأة طبية وقد تشكل انتهاكا لقوانين الحرب.
نحن لم نفضل أي مدنيين على الجنود على المدنيين على الإطلاق.
بس هذا يعرض المستشفيات أن تكون هدفا عسكريا.
الجيش هو كان فاهم تماما أن هذه المستشفيات قوات الدعم السريع هي تتلقى هذه الخدمة باعتبار أنه جزء من العقد أو نتيجة العقد المبرم بين قوات الدعم السريع وهذه المستشفيات.
We repeatedly tried to speak to the Sudanese army, but they didn't respond.
طبعاً يعني الواحد مهما كان يعني زعلان من حياته أو من غير مكترث لكن في نداء داخلي. يقول لك لابد إنك تنجو، لابد إنك تعيش. نهاية الواحد مثلاً ما يموت في حرب بينا اثنين جهلة. حاول أشوف لو التأشيرة بتاعتي اللي بترجعني تاني وأحاول أطلع. والله ما هوش أنا قاعد أدرس في الطرقات في الطريقة اللي مثلاً بيوديني لأقرب مطار. اثنين بس، يا جنوب السودان يا كمان أثيوبيا.
He's not answering.
Azhar is still trying to get her family out of Sudan.
And that was the one bus driver that's supposed to be taking my family tomorrow.
Azhar's family hasn't been able to tell her grandfather that his wife has died.
We're all kind of confused on how to tell him this. He put on his clothes and he was very kind of irritated and he started asking my dad for his keys, his house keys, his car keys, and he said, if you're not gonna give me, I'm gonna go walk back home because he wanted to check up on my grandmother.
Could the British Embassy have saved her grandmother's life had they been more responsive to Azhar's family's pleas?
I was informed they got 100 troops who came and evacuated their staff. They could not cross the road. I'm still very disappointed in them. And Giles Lever, the ambassador, the British ambassador in Sudan. Until now, there's no call, no initiative. They don't know how my grandparents are. They don't know how my grandfather is.
We asked the Foreign Office why they couldn't do more to help Azhar's grandparents. They told us,
The Sholgamis case is extremely sad. The ongoing military conflict means Sudan remains dangerous. Our ability to provide consular assistance is severely limited, and we cannot provide in-person support within Sudan.
Doctors around the world have been calling for an end to the targeting of medics in Sudan.
A very senior doctor and the medical forces is threatening doctors for treating the injured from both sides. Has this been addressed?
At this conference in London, doctors have already begun the process of trying to document possible war crimes.
أنا في وجودي في الخارج بنجمع كل هذه الدلائل وكل هذه الإفادات على أساس أنه هذه الانتهاكات تعتبر جرائم ضد الإنسانية وتعتبر جرائم ضد الحرب ممكن تقدم للجهات العدلية الدولية أو إذا كانت حصلت الظروف في السودان للجهات العدلية الوطنية داخل السودان.
When war crimes become a tactic of war, literally, people will no longer seek care and will be deprived of their right of access to health care. We do not want Sudan to become another situation where people are not seeking care because attacking hospitals is a war strategy.
Even though multiple ceasefires have been promised, the fighting in Sudan hasn't stopped and hospitals are still being targeted. Many thousands have decided the only solution is to leave.
أصوات اشتباكات ودانات يوم 4/5/2023 هذه آخر تسجيل للمكان الذي كنت أعيش فيه طوال فترة القصف الاشتباكات والآن أشد الرحال إلى مدينة القبارب منها إلى دولة أخرى مستودعا أهلي وأصدقائي على أمل أن أموت والسودان يشهد الأمن والأمان والازدهار لم أتخيل نفسي يوم من الأيام أن أغادر هربا مما يحدث داخل البلاد
Yok baba ana bana inanma. Ben de bakayım bunu. Hayır. 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 Hay